start with you, Jayesh, because I know about your commitment to this kind of transformative solutions, and also because what Coté was doing is he was saying something which I think is really key regarding the role of public policy vis-a-vis that kind of social entrepreneurship, okay? So there would have been a number of different things which could stop Coté, like for instance a regulation of not having open dispensaries for people for something which is called hygienic reasons, or because you want to, you have a rule that everything has to have a cap in order to be sold. So you can have many different ways of doing this. What's your take on this and how do you react to his story?
So thank you. First of all, it's very, very inspiring to learn about Coté's work, but I found something very fundamental about what he said. See, he began by saying that he moved into a low-income neighborhood and started living with the people. And I guess that is how he got all his insights. And I would mention this again and again and again, that this is really very fundamental. If we are serious about offering solutions, about offering products to some of the most pressing problem that people face, then you have to be bottoms up. Many times, as he rightly pointed out, people create a technology and then they try to ram it down your throat because the value is in the technology, but not really whether it is relevant in all contexts. So very little of grassroots original research happens. And as I said, this is the key, that you live with the people, work with them, get their mind space, and then co-create solutions which will be sustainable and working. So whatever work which we also try to do, that is the approach, that you take a very bottoms-up kind of approach.
Thank you for pointing this out, because one of the things which Coté is using as a term when he's speaking at other places, he uses the term also invention or innovation from the bottom of the pyramid, right? And that is actually a term which Osama and the Digital Empowerment Foundation is doing very much, and that's also something which we are talking about, that we in WSA should actually look at more and more and more to basically also encourage that kind of innovation. Alejandra, how you are reacting to that kind of story, and in which way does the kind of business you're running and fit into that kind of social entrepreneurship and this kind of ingenuity to look at things, and that was his main point, from a different perspective? Yeah. Do you want to take a microphone? Yeah. If you do that, and if you speak right into it, then people can hear you.
Hello? Yes. Yeah, it's very amazing, the story. And in my case, I'm in conservation, biodiversity conservation, and I see tourism and for conservation of biodiversity very similar in the way that you look at the things. It's different, but the point is that normally the relation between humans and species is seen very theoretical, very in the top of the pyramid, and no in the bottom. For example, if you think about a Darwin frog, which is a very specific species that lives all his life in 3 square meters, and as human being, if you know that, you know how to relate with that specific species. So,
Which species is this?
The Darwin frog.
Okay, Darwin frog.
The Darwin frog, yes.
Does everybody know a Darwin frog? Yes, okay, everybody?
Yes.
Even Germans know Darwin frogs? No, they don't
in
know.
In the Leipzig Zoo, they have a project of the Darwin frog.
Okay.
Yeah, but the interesting thing is that you normally think to make a lot of complex things to conserve biodiversity, but simple to make one single trail to move from one place to the other, you can conserve the Darwin frog and be your neighbor. So in the Willy Willy Biological Reserve, we have make this changing of thinking, and to teach with tourism about all the species, how you can, as human being, relate with them, and so you can live in nature, just enjoy it, but also make that the species also develop themselves with you. This is
what I really liked, Liva, is what Coté said is you cannot put planet against product. So do you have planet and product? You have to really, I mean, change that. In which way does that in your ecosystem in Lithuania play out? And is there something which you want to add to his story?
Yes, of course.
Okay.
I think, you know, these things that we are facing, the problems are very similar.
You speak up a little bit more.
I think the problems that we are facing anywhere are very similar. And ecosystems, of course, we can differ, and how we tackle them can differ. So, yes, I come from Lithuania. For many, many years, I worked in the government, in institutions responsible for digitalization. Lately, I'm working in energy companies, global company, which is developing solutions for the governments and consulting in digital transformations. But besides that, as well, I am Lithuania's national expert for many years, for instance, 2012 for WSA. So this is, besides my understanding of the digital transformation of public sector, this unique participation in WSA provides me possibility to see what's new is being created every year by our digital innovators. And just two stories which I think can add nicely to what we already discussed. One of our of my national winners from 2020, called Sign on Tap, we develop solution which is for creation of digital documents and management of digital documents, which you do on the tablet. So how to get rid of paper? And the beauty is that they very successful growth started when they found a very correct, let's say, sector to do that, which is healthcare. Because precisely there, it's where lots and lots of documents are being generated. You come to a hospital, you have to fill in different consent forms. There is an operation has to be done, lots of paper. So what these guys did, they really got very, very deep into the process, understanding how the things work and what are the pain points. So when they come with their product now, and they are expanding very fast, we are not just in 100 locations, 100 different hospitals in Lithuania, we are already in Czech Republic, in Cyprus, in Poland, coming to India, by the way. So when they come to a new customer, we can say, look, I know the pain that you don't even realize that you have, and I know how to solve it. And that really opens the door. Because when you come and you say, I have a fantastic technology, but you don't understand if I really need it, it would be a bit of a challenge to convince a client to change and to disrupt the things how we are used to do things. And another quick example from the public sector is exactly that. Last year, we have one of the WSA winners from Lithuania, Every Tree Matters. Very nice technology, how to using satellite data and AI to monitor the forests in nearly real time to see if there are no like harm to the forest being done. The technology works. The institution which was likely partner in developing it through our GovTech Lab challenge framework said, yes, it's a very nice idea. Technology is there, but actual implementation in the work, actual inclusion into the daily processes, they are not still there. So what happened there, that European Space Agency was making a consortium of different players, and Coetus became a partner, now in charge of developing this forest monitoring solution, not just for one country, but for whole Europe. And again, it's a very interesting story, but the technology is there, even the wish is there, but not always the actual will to change of this actor is there.
Thank you very much, because that gets right away to the next question, which I think is very important also for Jaish. What is the challenge for a government to encourage and also to foster practical solutions to hack the climate crisis, especially a number of examples maybe from your own work in Telangana state?
Thank you. So I'll share an actual example. See, Koti also mentioned something else which is very impactful, which is to change perspectives. I mean, if you have to really innovate, you have to start applying different lenses. Now, all of us know that amongst multiple adverse consequences of climate change, One which can be potentially the most catastrophic is its impact on agriculture, on food systems. First of all, it will reduce at some point in time the quantity of food that is available to feed the population. But more than that, it will also impact livelihoods, because in a country like India or a state like Telangana, more than half the population survives through agriculture. That is their preferred, the most important livelihood. And if climate change adversely impacts agriculture, then livelihoods are also put in a very vulnerable situation. So there is something else also. Now, again, Koti said that there is a lot of learning which is available in the community itself. This is also true of agriculture. On the one hand, you can see farmers losing incomes, losing productivity, something else not working, crop losses and all that. But within the same region, you also notice that some farmers are doing exceedingly well. They are able to beat the trend. They are able to get more returns, better incomes and all that. So we started looking at this perspective, that why is it that some people are still able to do better while everyone else is doing poorly? But instead of leaving it only to an anecdotal kind of analysis or judgment, we decided to bring in hard data. So since the last 2 years, our government in Telangana, along with UNDP, we have started an initiative which is called DICRA, D-I-C-R-A, Data in Climate Resilient Agriculture. So we provide very high resolution data on 20 parameters. This is geospatial data. So satellite images, analysis for different geographies, different regions. And we calculate what is called a positive deviance, which are the farms, which are the regions where the agriculture performance is far better than the average. And obviously the negative deviances. And then we try to merge geospatial technology with ethnography. So people actually go to the farms to find out that those farms which have shown better performance, what has worked for them. And we have been able to highlight, we have been able to prepare a compendium actually. So agriculture in Telangana happens either in a dry land ecosystem or a wetland ecosystem or a garden land ecosystem. So for these three ecosystems, what are the good practices? So for example, how do you use locally available seeds? How does the community store the seeds through a seed bank? What kind of multi-cropping scenarios do you practice? What kind of integrated farming systems do you practice? How do you do subsoil spraying? How do you prepare the lands? How do you use drills? And so on and so forth. So almost 30, 40 best practices we have found. And we have been now able to target our interventions much better in the same region. So eventually, as he mentioned again, that changing the consumer behavior is also a very fundamental issue. Our experience shows that consumer behavior can be changed not through some experts going from outside and lecturing. I mean, that may work at some point, but that's a very long drawn process. It can work much more faster and quicker through peer-to-peer learning. If I can show to a farmer that your neighbor is able to get far better returns than you by practicing three specific interventions, which are easy for you to follow, it changes the situation dramatically. So this is the initiative that we are following, and the initial results are very, very encouraging. So after it was piloted in our state of Telangana, it has now been scaled up to 6 other Indian states, and UNDP folks tell us that there's lots of demand from Africa for replicating the same. And everything, this whole platform, DICRA, people can look it up. There's a huge GitHub repository on how to collect these data sets, how to, everything is open source, open software, open code, open AI. There's no kind of licenses that you have to procure. And we feel very satisfied with the kind of impact it is creating. Now it is covering almost 50 million hectares of farmland in India as of now. And 100 plus data scientists have contributed, 4,000 people are using it.
So it links very much up to what Ileana said before regarding, for instance, Evertree Matters, that is a similar kind of technology. However, what Kote was saying, and I come back to you one more time, was he was saying two things. One was that the motivation and also the impact from what his work is, almost very well recognized now, is that is basically of how to use large quantities and a let's say better price point if you have large quantities, and therefore it make it much more affordable to buy something, if it's oil or beans or coke or soap. But the other thing is, which I think is was very interesting, and he made this point of having basically the packaging as a wallet, basically changing consumer behavior regarding what is usually garbage creating. So the statistics which he put out, and we have some WSA winners in this room, they are fighting the deluge of plastics around the world. So if you are going to India, you can see there's a lot of garbage around in the public space. Is there a public policy which you think where you can address something like that packaging becomes a wallet as an incentive to people to change their behavior? If yes, what would that be? Elena, I would give Jayesh still the microphone. Thanks.
So it has been tried out recently with reasonable success. There are some annual pilgrimages in India, and a large number of people come there, and they carry all kinds of plastic. So there is a Hyderabad-based startup called Recycle, R-E-C-Y-K-A-L. Mm-hmm. And this is the model, that if you return back the plastics successfully, mm-hmm. you are given some incentive. And there's an interesting business model, but people have tried it out. So it is a mix of social enterprise, policy, and doing things at scale. So the pilgrimages that I speak about, literally million plus people would be embarking on that pilgrimage. So there are very good examples, and possibly this is the way the future will move into, a combination of enterprise, policy, and insights into consumer behavior.
Liva, you're nodding and to what Jayesh is saying. What he's addressing is, go ahead, Alav.
Yeah, because when I'm hearing that, several years ago in Lithuania, we installed this very successful project at the national level, how to collect plastic bottles. And it works so nicely because every time you deliver a bottle, you get back 10 euro cents. I think in a couple months after launch, we surpassed the annual KPIs for the first year, because when people feel, they know that it is a very tangible reward for that, so it works very nicely. The issue is that in some cases, it's really easy to find this working business model, and it can even surprise how successful it works. But in quite a lot of issues which we face, it's not so easily found. And each good example as such is very valuable to analyze and try to understand why it works, how this economic logic works here, and how to apply it elsewhere. Because as long as we stay just about educating is important, understanding is important, numbers are scary, and we know we are not delivering, but are we ready to start changing now, sacrificing something that is important? So that's, I guess, the question.
But the interesting thing about what you're saying is that for each plastic bottle you pay, you get back 10 cents, is exactly picking up also on what Kote was saying, is basically having a double benefit. You get money back and you are reducing the plastic garbage. So, and that is something, you know, where we have to strategically think about double benefit. And that was, is part of his smarts. What do you think, Kote?
Actually, there's different models to solve the packaging problem. One of them is the deposit scheme, which is you put like a subsidized or an extra cost to a packaging to give an incentive to bring them back. What I'm trying to do with El Gramo is to leapfrog recycling, which is a totally different topic.
That's right.
But today we have a lot of focus on recycling, and recycling, especially on plastic, is not solved yet, and it's not working. We are recycling less than 10% globally of the plastic, which is what we are collecting, to be honest, and then from that, only 2% out of the 9 gets really recycled. The rest is like downcycling, which is a different product. So what I'm trying to do is to avoid that, jumping over it, and focus on reuse. The detergent bottle that we're using with Unilever is exactly the same from the shelf, from the single use. We didn't change at all, just a new label. And we have users reusing that over 100 times, exactly the same one. So the problem is not even the material itself, it's how we relate with that packaging. And of course, the first thing should be reused, and then at the last moment, should be recycled. Recycle is the like break in case of emergency, okay, let's recycle it. But before that, we should be focusing a lot on reuse, reduce and reuse.
Thank you. I think that's a very important aspect to leapfrog the recycling. And it's obviously the case that reduce, reuse, and then only recycle is a very clear step in the ecological way of thinking about hacking the climate. What are you doing in terms of the business you're running in terms of reuse, reduce, and then recycle?
Yeah, I want to start a little bit of the recycling of the industry that was before in the Willow area. And it's nice to explain you a little bit about that. In the Willow Reserve is 100,000 hectares of a privately protected area. And in this area, from the years 1950, 1960, timber cutting was the main activity. And the villages there, Neltume and Puerto Fui, were completely timber cutting villages. My family came there in 1997 with the timber cutting industry, but it was really in decreasing. And it was a very problematic situation for my family too. A lot of unemployment, and all the people have to reinvent themselves. What should we do in this place to go ahead, to conserve the place? But so, at that point, my mother and father were the Yvonne Reifschneider and Victor Peterman. They had this purpose. How can we conserve this amazing place with the people to the future? But for that, you need an economic activity. Yeah, because when you have human beings, you have to, and the point was there, similar to what you did, to see things differently. Because in this place, nobody thought it was an amazing place that time. 25 years ago, nobody went there, only 5,000 tourists yearly, but only to see the amazing waterfall. But then they get away from these villages, Neltume and Puerto Fui. So what they started to do from that time, the 2000, was to show the world the amazing place that it is. So they make a lot of investigations about ferns, about butterflies, about fungi, about everything to show the world. And on the other side, they build this architecture, very special, like that you said, what is really known. Nobody knows the other part, but the architecture is really known. Very exotic, and really the Magic Mountain Lodge, for example, which attract journalists to look at the place. At the moment, we have more than 270,000 visitors coming to the place, similar to Torres del Paine. And the point here, the interesting thing is that the behavior of the timber cutting people, myself as a kid and my parents, is so different, and the behavior as the nowadays tourist entrepreneurs business, because you relate to nature different. It's not because the timber cutting person were bad persons. They didn't knew, with the diving frog example, they didn't knew the diving frog exists, he lives in 3 meters, but with the tourism, we investigate about the different species, so the people now knows how to behave with the other species. So in this sense, the tourism as a tool for conservation, it's in this sense that you change behavior of people, and it was like recycling a villages, a place from one business to another that can now conserve the place.
Thank you very much, Alexander. Mm-hmm. We have another 10 minutes for a conversation with you here. Hacking the climate crisis is not something which can be done with an app from your bedroom and from your home, but you have to engage everybody. Who wishes to ask a question, make a comment, and things like this? Renuka, can I just hand you the microphone and then you keep it and hand it to the next person? Sure. Thank you.
I have a question for Koti, actually.
You have to speak up, please.
I have a question for Koti.
And introduce yourself so that people know who you are.
Okay. I'm Renuka from Malaysia. I've come across a lot of entrepreneurs that are trying to do what you're doing, and I think you've done it very successfully. I'd like you to share, please, the conversations that you had with the big brands to convince them to do what you're doing with them. Because as much as the brands have got lip service in terms of what they want to do in reduce, reuse, and recycle, to make them change will take a lot. And I think that would be very helpful for a lot of the startups here.
Okay, the question is, what did you do when you talked to the big brands?
Yes, a really relevant question, I would say. First of all, I adapted my pitch to their language. So I wasn't pitching about saving the world or saving the packaging. I was talking the Excel language. So I was trained on that in university, so I used that at that moment. Because think that in front of you, someone has been trained and worked for 25 years on single-use packaging, they're expert in the world. Think of this. They do their marketing based on the packaging. So for them, it's good to have single-use because they can change new formula of coral reef, scent, whatever. And they change every year. So suddenly, the packaging is forever. Has been all the time, but now they realize. And how to convince that guy that their work is going to change. And this is not going to be reflecting their KPI and their bonus at the end of the year. So it's a huge challenge. So one, I would say it's language. Secondly, I would say that it's a personal relation. So it's not a logo, it's not a corporation, it's someone. And if you engage with someone, they will realize why you're doing what you want to do. So you need to have like a what they call champion inside the corporation, someone that explains you how this works. Think that I haven't been working in somewhere else in my whole life, so I haven't have a boss or working in a big corporation, so I didn't know how this worked, and they helped me to navigate this. So I would say that would be the second one. And the third one is to be really concrete. So it's not say, okay, I'm trying to save some packaging. Why don't we join? No, I want to do this and this, and this will have these consequences. It's going to cost you this, etc. And sometimes when I see some entrepreneurs willing to do something with big corporations, they have like a really good global pitch, but they're not have the ask. And that would be my third recommendation. There would be like 10, huh? But I would say that would be the top three.
Thank you very much. So do you want to give the microphone to Dorothy, please?
Oh, okay. Let him speak. Oh, okay. I think that what's coming across is very interesting, because what you were just saying, you have to have a certain level of humility to understand that what you want is not necessarily the most important thing. It's the listening. And if we look at the innovation hubs that we have all over the world now, every country has so many innovation hubs, these kind of skills are not being taught. You don't see innovation hubs encouraging the startups to go and actually explore what their customer wants and how to organize with their customer. In fact, there's a level of, I'm trying to be diplomatic, a level
of
superiority that the average developer, software developer would have vis-a-vis somebody who lives in a village or somebody who lives in a forest or even somebody who gets dirty playing with frogs. This is not where our developers want to find themselves. So I think there's a lot of re-education that needs to take place and reorientation of what goes on within a hub, you know, because now we see a lot of retrofitting. You just study the store, see what's trending, and you try and create it for your market. But we could do so much more with those brains. And then the other thing that I want you to really comment on, and maybe Peter, you have to come in. I strongly believe that we are not going to solve our plastic problem without very strong public policy. You see, there are countries where bags have been banned, everybody goes round with their bag, and it saves so many plastic bags. You see, there's a way we can material science can build the bottle in such a way that it will self-destruct. These are things that we have to do. I don't see that we're going to be able to solve those kind of big issues without very serious public policy. And we have global commitments, you know, maybe because I'm very happy with what you said about UNDP, because I used to work in UNDP India. But we have global commitments at the level of the UN. So the governments have to have the policy that supports. For me, okay. I think that the European Union has now got a lot of regulations that companies have to fulfill if they're going to operate within the EU. So we have to see that.
You have in Austria provinces where it's outlawed for hotels to offer single soap, single shampoo, single thing bottles. What is happening in your hotel?
We are exactly trying to, to refill with the...
So you have refillable.
We are
trying because, or did you do it?
Because in the reality, what we have in a country like Chile, we make it with one, we make a joint venture with some Chilean also entrepreneur, and we were very happy before pandemic, but afterwards he bankrupt. So all the bottles we have with him, the refilling and everything, we have to reinvent it, you know?
Okay.
So it's not easy, and I think the way that you have advanced, that you find a solution, but then you have to reinvent yourself again to have another solution. So
why don't you have edible soap?
Sorry?
Edible soap. You can eat your soap.
This could be also good.
Yeah, yeah. Very good. Okay, exactly. Good. So we come back to the public policy issue, but there's a question first here. Please speak up and introduce yourself.
Yeah. I'm Amir Richani. I am from Venezuela. It's more of a comment, but it talks to what Cote described. I think in times of crisis, consumers' thoughts can change. An example of that was during the tough crisis in Venezuela. People started using mayonnaise jars as glasses. You would go to any restaurant in Venezuela, and this would be the glass that you would be served in. So they kept using the jars for any types of juices. And when it comes to detergent, I was seeing your solution. Everyone reuses the detergent bottle. We have exactly what Algramo does, but you just take your bottle there. So I just wanted to say that sometimes in negative scenarios, consumerism thinking can really change depending on how deep a crisis can be. Thank you.
Thank you for this. Jayesh, do you want to answer to what Dorothy Gordon was saying from Ghana regarding that it needs stronger public policies? How far are you away in Telangana from outruling plastics in terms of packaging and disallowing people to have plastic bags and everything else?
See, but public policy also, I'll make three comments actually. See, first is that public policy is an evolving kind of an issue. So in India, many states have banned single-use plastic. But then it became evident that there is a huge industry which manufactures single-use plastic. Hundreds of workers work in them. And you are jeopardizing their livelihoods. So how do you kind of take care of them? So another layer of complexity gets added. So that is one. The second important thing is that no amount of public policy will succeed unless you have the buy-in of the average user, the public. And the public will not give in to any policy just because there is a law on paper. I mean, how do you enforce? What is the cost of compliance? If you do not comply, can you get away with it? So there are much more important sociological nuances behind that public policy. The third insight is that more than public policy, you can still change behavior through what is called the nudge theories, or coincidentally, Robert Kahneman, who passed away recently, he has spoken a lot about all these issues in his book. So you do require a template of public policy, but to get actual action, policy get translated into action, you need to do a lot more, including creating strong community groups, receiving mechanisms in the groups, and so on and so forth.
The microphone, please. Put it, where did the microphone go? Where is the microphone, please? No, just a second. The microphone is coming. Thank you.
Thank you. But the governments, the world's governments, have already signed onto these commitments. Everything you say makes perfect sense. It is the reality. But once you have signed in and you've given yourself some targets, there have to be concrete steps to be able to get there. And yes, people will be out of a job, but the other option is that we lose our planet.
So you're arguing the coal mining issue.
Pardon?
The coal mining issue.
Yes,
all the coal miners are out of the job.
Please let somebody comment on the innovation hubs, please.
I think there's 2 points that could be quite relevant for this discussion. One that actually I'm participating on it, there's a negotiation around a plastic treaty within the UN. This year will be finished, and it's going to be a binding. So maybe it's not going to be that aggressive, but it's going to be binding. One of the chapters
is a convention, so it's not just a
it's not
policy.
A guideline, it's not a recommendation, it's an obligation. There will be funding for this, and there are going to be, hopefully, targets on reuse. That's my goal, and actually I'm flying there on Sunday to focus on that. That's one thing. But the second one, I think it's quite relevant, is to talk about just transition as well. So it's not just focusing on the environment, but also on people. And for example, in my case, what we are doing, we're trying to work with waste pickers to help them to move from collecting waste to be what we call reuse partners. So they're going to be from collecting, from the garbage to being collecting reusable packaging, washing them and returning them. They're going to have higher income. They're going to be part of the formal sector. So I would say that this is just one example, but the just transition is a quite relevant piece. It's not just changing the regulation, but also thinking on the base of the pyramid, how this is going to affect lives and how we could help them to be part of this transition in a green,
excellent,
with green jobs and regulation.
Excellent point. Dorothy asked the question about listening in the ecosystems and in incubators. Please, Liva.
Thank you, Dorothy. It's a very good point. And actually, I have a very good example, or even several of them. There is this specific type of innovation hubs, let's call GovTech Labs. In Lithuania, we established it already like 6 years ago and experimenting a lot with that.
How are you calling these labs?
GovTech Labs.
GovTech Labs. Okay.
So that's precisely the logic how it works, that you have an institution which has a pain, a challenge it wants to solve. You have a smart team of developers, of people who understand digital, and we work together for a structured process to develop a prototype, and if it works, then you go full scale. And things which during that process, we are being provided trainings and capacity building, especially to understand the problem, understand the client. And this example, this know-how is being applied from my team of us consultants in Trinidad and Tobago, for example, which has its own D-Hub, and one of the trainings which we had just recently gave to the local developers was precisely how to understand the problem, how to understand the client, and how to work towards solution which would not just be smart, digital, very intelligent thing, but which would actually solve a problem. And just I'm extremely happy that this DIHA project for Trinidad and Tobago just became one of the winners of CIS this year and will be awarded the nice prize in Geneva at the end of May. So good practice is spreading, and this is very important.
Very good. Thank you very much. Anybody else? I take one more question if anybody wishing to intervene. Yes, please, Dani. There's a microphone.
Thank you. It's a question for Alexandra, actually. We've been talking a lot about innovation, public policy, and more practical things like about plastic. But also one of the reasons that WSA this year is in Patagonia, Northern Patagonia, is because of all the conservation actually that is around and how that is connected to help biodiversity, climate crisis, etc. So what would you say is really the role of conservation or tourism that this specific part of the world has in for collaborating on hacking climate crisis?
Yeah, thank you, Danny, for the question. Yeah, actually, tourism, as we, I'm not a tourist expert, but after this very long years, I think I'm working on that. But actually, as I in this adventure that it has been Willow Willow Biological Reserve, we can see that if you the worst thing is that you don't know something. If you don't know it, you don't value it, and you don't conserve it. You can try people to conserve things, but if they don't really value them and they don't know it, they will not do it. So what we think about tourism is that it makes people, the 80% that are not convinced of conserving, that come to amazing places, that get in touch with this little frog or with this whale or with all these animals, and they really take care, so get involved emotionally too. Not only from to do things, not only I have to recycle, I have to, but in another way that you say, oh, I want to be related to this little creature. How can I help to conserve something in my what I do to help him? So in this sense, tourism is, for in my vision, so important. The sustainable tourism bring people that are not convinced of conserving to conservation because they get emotionally involved with nature. And this, I think, is the key that is important for this meeting. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Alexandra. Let's give Alexandra a hand, please. How about a hand for Kuti Miller? How about a hand for Leva? And a hand for Rajesh? Let me sum up this session. We need more people to fall in love with their problems. Thank you very much.